Good afternoon. My name is Rebecca Kennel, and I am a Director of Research and Analysis at the Commission. It is my distinct pleasure today to introduce the next two speakers of our fireside chat on a topic focused on AI for humanity. So please would you welcome the two speakers who need no introduction, Dr. Henry Kissinger and Dr. Nadia Schadlow.
Okay, can everyone hear me? Okay, good. So first we'll have to use our imagination a little bit because there is no fireplace here, but we are thinking it's a fireside chat. And I'm so grateful to have this opportunity today. Dr. Kissinger and I met several years ago now, I think, right? Dr. Kissinger, he was has been a key person where you can go to for advice about both professional and career things as well as geopolitical events, right? Very few friends can do both. But Dr. Kissinger really needs no introduction. As all of you know, he's one of the world's most renowned geopolitical practitioner as well as thinker. And he did all of that well before AI came into being. He has that rare combination also of a true intellect, and I really admire him for taking on something relatively new like AI after the height of his career. AI is pretty daunting as someone also relatively new to it, coming to it. Dr. Kissinger decided he wanted to do a deep dive to learn more about the technology and about the implications of artificial intelligence for our political systems and for geopolitics writ large. As many of you know, he's written two articles, both published in The Atlantic, 2018 and 2019. I'd encourage you all to read both of them. He also wrote a book in 2014, preceding that, called World Order. And one of the last chapters of that book, One of the last chapters of the book talks about the implications of technology. It has a really interesting insight. He talks about the ordering system for the world. So during the Age of Enlightenment, it was reason. In the medieval period, it was religion. In today's era, it's technology and science that helps us sort out events, and I think that that's a useful way to think about what we're going to talk about. He called them actually the governing concepts of our age. He also made several points in the articles that are relevant to the commission as well, and I'll draw out some of these, use them as questions to start out with, and then open it up to questions from the audience. First, he described AI as inherently unstable. AI systems are constantly in flux as they acquire and analyze new data. Now, to those of you in the audience who are national security professionals, stability is a key concept that we like to actually have in the system. So there's an inherent contradiction between the stability of AI and national security concepts. And that's something I'd like Dr. Kissinger to talk about a little bit. But even preceding that, we're here really ultimately as we talk about this competition and about the tension that the interim report also talks about, because ultimately this is a contest between two political systems, right? And we shouldn't forget that essentially. It's fundamentally between two political systems and the impact that artificial intelligence will have on those systems. It's about whether or not artificial intelligence will advantage open and democratic countries like ours or authoritarian states. And that's something I'd like to start off with by asking Dr. Kissinger to talk a little bit about his views about that, and then we'll move on to a couple of other questions. Thanks, Dr. Kissinger.
Thank you very much, Nadia. I've had the pleasure of working with Nadia on several projects, and I've seen her on the advisor to the president's job, also when it ended. and we were on the defense advisory board together. So it's a great pleasure to be here. So that you can calibrate what I'm saying, let me give you a few words about how I got into this field. I became a great friend of Eric Schmidt, who is today one of my best friends. He invited me to give a speech at Google. And before that, they showed me some of their extraordinary achievements. And I had barely met Eric before that. And I began my speech by saying, I'm tremendously impressed by what I've seen, but I want you all to understand that I consider Google a threat to civilization as I understand it. This was the beginning of our friendship. And the next step in my being here was, I was at an international conference which in Europe, which on its schedule had a provision for artificial intelligence. And I thought this was a great opportunity for me to catch up on my jet lag. And I was heading out of the door when Eric, who was standing there, said, "This might interest you, and you really ought to hear it. Except for that, you might have been spared this occasion." So I went there, and somebody from DeepThink was explaining that he was designing a computer that would be able to play the game of Go. And he was confident that he could design it so that it would beat the champions of China and of Korea. And the and as you know, Google, that Go has 180 pieces for each side, beginning on an open square, and the strategic goal of the game is to constrict the ability of the opponent until he can't move at all. But when you put your first piece down, it's not like chess that you have it lined up. You put your first piece down, you don't know how this is going to develop. And it takes a long time to develop. So the idea that you could design a computer that could master this as a creative game seemed extraordinary to me. And I went up to this speaker afterwards and said, "How long will it be that we become incas to the Spanish computers? That they will achieve an intellectual dominance?" And he said he was working on that. And he is. So over the years, Eric was kind enough to introduce me to a lot of artificial intelligence researchers. And I look at it not as a technical person. And I don't challenge or debate the technical side of it. I am concerned with the historical, philosophical, strategic aspect of it. And I've become convinced that artificial intelligence and the surrounding disciplines is going to bring a change in human consciousness exceeding that of the Enlightenment because of the inherent scope of the investigations it imposes. So that's why I'm here. And I gave a speech at Stanford a few weeks ago at the opening of the Artificial Intelligence Center. And I said, it's sort of absurd that I'm here. You people who sit in the audience, I said to them, have written thousands of articles. I've written two, and one was a joint authorship with Eric and one other person. And I said, the only significance of my presence and of what I do, I said, you people work on the implications, on the applications. I work on the implications. And I don't challenge the applications. I think they're important, they're crucial, but frankly, I think you don't do enough. You don't go the next step. Those of you who know something about the field, of what does it mean if mankind is surrounded by automatic actions that it sometimes cannot explain. It can unexplain what happens. But as I understand it, not always why it happens. So this is why I'm here. And it's in that context that you auto-assess what I'm saying. But I have put aside some other work for the last 3 years to work on this and to educate myself, because I think in the conceptual field that it's the next big step for mankind.
Hopefully they listened to you, Dr. Kissinger. Did they listen to you at the Stanford audience?
I think the technicians are too modest in the sense that they're doing spectacular things, but they don't ask enough of what it means. I would just say the same for strategists. This is bound to change the nature of strategy and of warfare. Because and some of you can judge better than I how much it's taken aboard yet. I don't think on the global field it is yet understood what this will do. It's still handled as a new technical departure. It's not yet understood that it must bring a change in philosophical perception of the world. Much of human effort has been to explain the reality around it. And the Enlightenment brought a way of looking at it on a mathematical basis and on a rational basis. That was a huge departure already that changed history fundamentally. But the idea that you can explore reality in partnership of what is out there, and that you explore it by means of algorithms where you know what they will produce, but you do not yet know why. That is when people start thinking about it. and when I say will, that will fundamentally affect human perceptions. And this way of thinking up to now, historically, has been largely Western thinking. Other regions have adapted it from the West, I mean the rationalistic thinking. As that spreads around the world, now unpredictable consequences are going to follow.
In the end, are you optimistic in terms of AI and its interaction with democracy, in AI changing human cognition, as you pointed out, in AI having explanatory powers or not the humans having explanatory powers, AI not necessarily? There's an interesting point that you make in some of your articles about how AI, by its very nature, is going to change human cognition and reasoning because we will not have had the experiences that AI will get to it. AI will get there first before us.
Well, the point I made is AI has consequences that we elicit, but we don't always know why. And so, now, am I optimistic? First, I would have to say, honestly, the future of democracy itself, putting AI aside, it's something that should concern us, because for a society to be great, it has to have a vision of the future. That is to say, it has to go from where it is to where it has never been, and have enough confidence in itself to do it. When you look at too many democracies, the political contest is so bitter and the rivalries are so great that to get an objective view of their future, it's getting more and more difficult. Who would have thought that the House of Commons could break down into a collection of pressure groups operating like the House of Representatives, but the House of Representatives is part of a system of checks and balances, while Britain is based on a unitary system that requires consensus for its operation. So what AI does is to inject a new level of reality, of a new level of perceiving reality. Most people don't understand that yet. Most people don't know what it is. But I think that those of you who work on it are pioneers in an inevitable future. And when we think in the Defense Department about the future, this is a huge problem, because increasingly AI will help shape the approaches to problems. For example, I was in office in the period of massive, it started with massive retaliation and then developed into various applications. But the key problem we face in actual crisis as security advisor, how do you threaten with nuclear weapons without triggering a preemptive strike on the other side? And as the weapons themselves became more esoteric, even in terms of the 70s, when we moved to fixed land-based missiles, they had a high potential for retaliation, but next to no potential for being used diplomatically. It's often, when histories of that period are written, there are debates about the trigger happiness of an administration that went on alert. We went on alert from level 4 to level 3, which isn't a high level of alert, but nobody, no newspaper reader notes that. But one reason we went on alert was because we could generate a lot of traffic on, and you could see things that were being done. Planes were being put in the air and troops were being called, but themselves, they were not yet threatening.
With AI, you can't see a lot of that activity.
Well, even with mobile missiles, you had trouble. And much of what goes on in AI, we believed that arms control was an important aspect. And what you know of AI, it makes it infinitely more important, but much of what you can do in AI, you don't want to put on the table as a capability to be restricted because its secrecy is itself part of its strength. But so in the field of strategy, we are moving into an area where you can imagine capabilities of extraordinary capability of, and even permitting tremendous discrimination. And one of your problems is that the enemy may not, if you choose, may not know where the threat came from for a while. So you have to rethink what were elements of arms control, and you have to rethink even how the concept of arms control, if at all, applies to that world.
You have a nice line in one of the articles about how AI essentially upends all of the strategic verities that we've taken, that we've sort of had as part of our way of thinking over the past 30 years, including arms control, including deterrence, including, as we talked about in the beginning, stability. But I wanted to ask you one specific question, and then I'll open it up. So are there situations in which, going backwards, you're at the White House again taking decisions, are there situations in which today AI, you would trust an AI algorithm to make a decision at that level in the national security space if you're faced with a tough decision? Are there areas where you could see AI algorithms helping national security decision makers?
I think it will become standard that AI algorithms will be part of the decision-making process. But before that happens, or as that happens, the decision-makers have to think through the limits of it. And what might be wrong with it, and they have to test themselves in war games and even in some actual situations to make sure that what degree of reliability they can give to the algorithms. And also, they have to think through of the consequences. When I talk about these things, I think I studied a lot about the outbreak of World War I, because the disparity between the intention of the leaders and what they produced is so shocking. Not one of the leaders who started the war in 1914 would have undertaken it if they had had any conception of what the world would look like in 1918 or even in 1917. None wanted an act of such scope. They thought they were dealing with a local problem and they were facing each other down, but they didn't know how to turn it off. That once the mobilization process started, it had to go to an end, in which a crisis over Serbia ended with a German attack on Belgium, which neither of which had anything to do with the original crisis. But the attack on Belgium was an absolutely logical consequence of a system that had been set up and that required a quick victory. And the quick victory could only be achieved in northern France. So never mind that there is a crisis in the Balkans and that Germany and France are not directly involved in the outcome. The only way to get a advantage in time over the possible mobilization of Russia was to defeat France, no matter how the war started. And it was a masterpiece of planning. Then one of the really interesting things is that they had to knock out, the Germans had to knock out France within 6 to 8 weeks. And the man who designed this plan allegedly said on his deathbed, make sure my right flank is strong. So when the attack developed and then Russia began to move in the east, the Germans lost their nerve and pulled two army corps out of their right flank, which is exactly where they were stopped. These two army corps were in transit while the important battles on both sides were taking place. I mentioned that only that if you don't see through the implications of the technology to which you've wedded yourself, and including your emotional capacity to handle the predictable consequences, then you're going to fail. That's on the strategic side. And how you conduct diplomacy when even the testing of new weapons can be shielded, so you really don't know what the other side is thinking. And it's not even clear how you could reassure somebody if you wanted to. That's a topic very important to think about. And so, as you develop weapons of great capacity and even great discrimination, how do you talk about them? And how do you build a restraint on their use? So And how do you convince them? I mean, the weapons, in a way, become your partner. And if they're assigned certain tasks, how you can modify that under combat conditions? These are all key questions which have to be answered and will be, I'm sure, answered in some way. And so that's why I think you're only in the foothills of the real issues that you'll be facing as you go down that road, as you must. I'm not here arguing against AI. We are, AI will exist and will shape us.
Before I open it up to the audience, just a quick comment, because you are a geopolitical thinker and you've talked about diplomacy and restraint. Could you comment a little bit on how you see the evolution of the U.S., China, and Russia relationship, just in brief, and then I will open it up to the audience. But I think it's a missed opportunity to have Dr. Kissinger here and not to ask a question that's a little bit broader.
Asking me for brief answers. Sign of great faith.
You're getting set to go to China, so we've been talking a little bit about some of your goals for that trip.
I look at this primarily as a strategic issue. That is, the impact of the societies on each other over an extended period of time when they have such huge capabilities. Now, the conventional way, the historic way this has been handled is that some military conflict settles the relative position of the sides. And sometimes at huge cost, but historically at survivable cost. So the key question is, do we define our enemy and then conduct our policy from a confrontational point of view and with confrontational language at every stage? As against my preference of looking at it as a strategic issue in which at every moment you try to shape the environment to get, on the one hand, a relative advantage, but on the other hand, give your opponent an opportunity to move towards a less threatening position. And so, if your basic strategy is confrontation, then the other side loses nothing by being confrontational, because it's there anyway. And therefore, I believe one should put an element of potential cooperation into these strategic relationships. I've studied at one point, I was in office in the 73 war, and there's a little booklet by somebody who served on the Politburo as a note taker. And if you go through that book, you'll see that on the one hand, they have arguments and leaning towards involvement and armed supply. But on the other, there's always somebody arguing about what we call détente, so that they didn't ever go all out. And so we could outmatch them when we went in there. So I favor a strategy of complexity. And so I would like containment to evolve out of a diplomacy that doesn't put it into a confrontational style. What that means is that we, on our side, have to know what our limits are. And we have to understand what we're trying to avoid in addition to what we want to achieve. So we have to have strategies in high office, which is not the way we select people. But we've got to come to, I'm talking about what we have to come to. So when you look at strategic designs of the 19th century, the Europeans had one of direct of lines with armies on both sides. The British, on the road to India, had a lot of alliances and friendships, but not such a precise system. But when you got on the road to India, before you got very far, you'd meet a lot of resistance organized by the British, even though it was not proclaimed, and nobody ever quite made it. I'm talking about 19th century. So that's what we have to develop, at least in some parts of the world. And now, I don't put Russia into quite the same category, because Russia is a weak country. It's a weak country with nuclear weapons. And one of its utilities is its existence, because by sitting there in the middle of Eurasia, it guarantees by its existence the absence of Yugoslavian-type conflicts in the middle of Central Asia, where it would draw in the Greek, the Turkish, the Persian, and all the other erstwhile empires. So what I think we need is a way of thinking about the world in that category. The basic principle has to be, we cannot tolerate hegemony of anybody over parts of the world we consider essential for our survival. So we cannot tolerate the hegemony of any country over Eurasia. But how to get there would require flexible thinking and flexible technology. And we've never been faced with such a situation. And also, if you go to most universities, you will find many, the huge majority, that will contradict this approach. So maybe I'm wrong.
So I'll open it up now.
Almost unthinkable.
Clearly, some of your ideas about that strategic design can find a way to work its way into the AI Commission report. So I'll talk to Ely about that. But I'll open it up now to questions. There is a glare, so it's hard to see. I do see someone in the back there.
Thank you, Dr. Kissinger. Thank you so much for talking to us today. My name is Elise Labatt. I'm a practitioner in residence at the Georgetown University School of Foreign Service. I was wondering if you could expand on your thoughts about the emotional intelligence quotient, and how do you take into account relying on AI for issues of emotional intelligence like empathy? When the internet was expanding, a lot of critics of the new technology said it would make humans less personal and mentally lazy, and the champions and the postmodernists said that it would free up the mind for bigger thoughts and more profound thinking, and that's true in some sense, but it's also being used by smaller-minded people to kind of spread their original negativity and thinking. So I'm wondering how you square intentions with the new avenues of AI. Thank you so much.
I don't know. I don't know the answer to this question, because you have defined what the problem is that we must deal with. When the Enlightenment came along, there were a lot of philosophers, because growing out of a religious period, there was a lot of reflection about the nature of the universe. And if you study the 16th, 17th, you find a lot of philosophers with very profound insights on the nature of the universe and whether the universe was an objective reality or whether it reflected the structure of your own mind, or whether you could express it in mathematical equations. But in our present period, philosophy and reflection is not a major, as major a concern. We put our talents into the technological field, and this is why it has happened that for the first time, world-changing events are happening which have no philosophic explanation or attempted explanation, but sooner or later it will come. I'm sort of obsessed with the Alpha Zero phenomenon of teaching chess to a computer who then learns a form of chess that no human being in all of history has ever developed or has ever worked, and against which we, with our traditional chess methods, even in the most advanced computers based on previous intelligence, is in a way defenseless. So what does that mean? That you were teaching something to somebody who did not learn what you set out to do, but learned something entirely different, and within that world, decisive. I don't know the answer to this, but it sort of obsesses me.
Does anyone else know the answer?
I mean, no. What else are we going to learn? No, I don't know. There are two levels of this. One, that I know a better answer. That'd be terrific. I've become very rich. But I'm 97, nearly. So that's to me. But the other answer is, the other concern isn't that we have to get our mind open to studying this problem. And we have to find people in the key jobs that are capable of strategy in relation to an ever-changing world, which is being changed by our own efforts. That has never happened before in that way. And we are not conscious of that yet as a society.
We have time for one final question before we wrap. Someone like to ask? Yes, sir.
So there's a story about the moon coming up over the horizon and this country going on alert, a strategic alert against Russia. But there were cooler heads that decided that it wasn't an attack. It was something else. So are what you're trying to say is we need very elegant AI before we put it in control of the button?
What am I saying?
Do you want to... Do you want to repeat the question? Or, I mean, essentially, do we need more elegant AI before we put it in control of the button? That was his question. Look,
in one way or another, AI will be the philosophical challenge of the future. Because on the one hand, you are in partnership with objects when you go to general intelligence. That's never even been conceived before. And in a deeper way, the implications of some of the things I'd sketched are so vast that unless one reflects about it before, I mean, for example, one thing is I'm told that self-driving cars, when they come to a stoplight, stop because they're engineered that way. But then when the cars next to them start inching forward to get a jump on the others, they do it also. Why? Where did they learn it? And what else have they learned that they're not telling us?
on that note, I think time is up now.
And how do they talk to each other?
Exactly. Well, thank you so
Next
much.
Next time I come here, I'll give you answers to that.
So we're gonna take a 10 minute break now, and then we will be meeting back here with Commissioner Mignon Clyburn, who will look at AI and the workforce. Thanks very much.